Okay, then I will do one more example. There are 3-4 examples here. So I will quickly do one more example. There is a third example given here. Please go and read. Actually, that's more interesting. I will not read here because that tells you how your vibrations and all that. How many pages left? Still in the 11th page. And I'm not going to do this. I'm going to do something else in the second lecture. You want to do this also? Fine. Alright. So you understood at least why do you need to do something more than obtaining the solution. Obtaining the solution is not enough. Two reasons, because that will not reveal you about your thing. Second thing, obtaining solutions itself may not be possible. That's where your existence theory and all that comes in. Okay? This is called, the curve is called a logistic or S-shaped curve. A by B is the limiting population. Now I go, this is another practical problem proposed by the United States to the Atomic Energy Department then. Okay, the problem is, so that's what I said, don't read everything. The problem is that they have a lot of nuclear waste. So they want to dispose the nuclear waste. So they put all this nuclear waste in very drums, sealed it properly, so that it will not have any outside depth. And then they went and dropped in the ocean. Okay, when you drop it in the ocean, initially the velocity is zero. That's how you set your initial condition. But when it goes through the water, it will develop velocity, right? Right? It will increase the velocity. Why it will increase the velocity? Due to gravity. But of course, there will be other forces. That's what you have to understand. And it will go, increase the velocity, and by the time it reaches the bottom, it may have certain velocity. And due to that velocity, these drums can break. Then the whole purpose is gone. So they were dumping it in a shallow water so that velocity won't go. But the government wants to know whether it will break or not. That's the question. So the question is given. This is given. This is dumped in the sea. You know, there are numbers, but mathematicians want to study fully. And then this is the depth of the water, was something like 300 feet or something. And you want to know whether the question is, government only one question. Will these drums will break as per mathematics or not? Want to do that one. So you want to know what's the law you apply? We have only Newton's law, right? Because this goes, so it will get up, so when you drop a thing, it will acquire the velocity. In the normal thing, it is due to the gravity. But then through the water, there are other forces. And you have to understand, you have to model it. So the Newton's law of motion is that, so I am measuring my y positive axis along the downward. So this is the way I am measuring. So this is your ground. So this is your yt. At time t, it will be here. At some, I don't know at what time it will reach, and I don't know what time is the velocity. So there are two things. One, at what time it reaches the bottom, and at that time, what's the velocity. So there are different issues. So they try to do a simple model like this. So here I want to show that sometimes the modeling may be correct, but the modeling will not give you the solution. It's not due to the failure of the model, doesn't give you solution. Doesn't mean that the model is all the time wrong. So they computed all the forces. There were three forces here, basically. One is the force due to gravity, that is increases the speed, but when it goes through the water, there will be two forces acting against the buoyancy force and the drag force. There are two more forces, B is the buoyancy force due to water, there will be a drag force due to water. And drag force is drag increases when the velocity increases. That's a simpler model. Okay? So that's the model. So I want an initial velocity zero. So you have an initial value problem, first, second order initial value problem. I want to write down WB and want to solve it. Okay? Because you know that in the actual problem, you know the measurements. This is 300 feet, everything. If you want to know, later. So, this is equal to mg. V is the buoyancy force. Drag force is generally, that's a simple model. So, I want to analyze it in a simpler case. The drag increases with certain proportionality constant that is proportional to the velocity. and the velocity is equal to dy by dt. Y is the distance, velocity. Substitute all that, you get a linear non-homogeneous equation. This is a right? This is a linear equation which you study in your thing. This is v is unknown, which is nothing but the velocity. So you are writing your equation in terms of the velocity. Okay? And then you have a linear model, Cg, everything coming from it. These are all, you know the parameter. What is Cg, what is g, what is w, all that you know it. Okay? And V0, you want to, this you know how to know it. You know the integrating factor. You have to learn by integrating. I'm asking you, you should ask why this integrating factor. You should start asking yourself. You should ask your colleagues. You should ask your teachers. Why integrating factor? What is all this terminology? Why do you want me to learn all this? You need justification. You should start asking those questions. Okay? You can solve it. Go and solve it. Whatever way it is, this is a non-homogeneous situation. If you solve it, you get this equation. Now, what is the limiting value? You are interested in t at some time t naught. If you are not interested actually if t tends to infinity, you do not even know what time it hits now. Right? So, one easy way is that Vt never, so they know that the drum will break if the velocity is greater than or equal to something. That information they already have it. If that box is dropped with the dropping time, velocity is something like 40 meter per second or something like that, the velocity. But the problem is that you do not know what time it is hitting. One way to attack this problem is that your limiting value itself is less than that. Suppose you could prove that the velocity will never reach there even at t equal to infinity. So whatever be the time, it will hit, it will never break. That's the easiest solution. So if you have that successfully, you are done. So first you do an analysis as t tends to infinity. When t tends to infinity, this goes to 0. Because this is positive, this goes to 0. So Vt tends to this number. When these values are known to you, but that value is somewhat like a 700. But your value which is breaks the drum is 40. If this number happened to be less than 40, you are done. Your problem is solved. You can tell immediately your government, it will never reach that velocity. The problem is that only when t tends to infinity, 700 reaches. The question is that, will it reach 40 before it hits? That you do not know. So this model immediately does not answer your question. So you want to remodel the same thing in L. You understood what I am trying to say? Right? Because you know that at infinity it reaches above. That doesn't mean that while it reaches 40. So you want to know the time it reaches. Then you can compute it. But computing the time is something different. So the researchers try to solve it in the slightly different way. Instead of solving for the, instead of forming a differential equation for the velocity, they try to form the differential equation for the distance. So they remodel the same differential equation in terms of the distance. So if Vy is the velocity, okay, at the height y, measuring downwards, so Vy is the velocity y, then you are the velocity at time t. So the velocity at time t, I can write it as the velocity with respect to the distance. So far we have formulated the problem with the velocity with respect to time. I can write the same thing, velocity with respect to when it is that this much distance, not this much. So two ways of thing. I can say that either the velocity at that time it reaches or the velocity at that distance it. Why I couldn't achieve the previous problem? Because t was unknown. The distance, yeah, I know it when it, because it is given to you. So you rewrite the equation, change of variable formula, okay, not change of variable, what do you say? Composite rule for the applying the composition formula for difference. dv by dt will be dv by dy into dy by dt. Substitute it, you get an equation of this form. Unfortunately, this equation is non-linear. You see, more practical problems are more complicated. Linear problems are simple to do, but then linear problems will not give you answer. Just like previously we saw, even in this case, you are getting a non-linear problem. So I want to solve this equation. Interestingly, this problem is still solvable. You are lucky. Both examples rather because I put the examples which are like that. So you can get an equation for V in an implicit form like this. But now, earlier you could manage some trick, I could remove my modulus. But now, this is a highly non-linear problem, V coming here, Y coming here, V coming here, inside log. This is not easy to write V in terms of Y, my brother. Okay, so you have an expression, you are not able to still write your V of Y in terms of Y, because I want to know V of 300, because the depth of that is 300. I should know that V of, then that time you may, most of the time you will end up with such expressions. So if you can't do any analysis, you do a numerical computation. And using a numerical computation, you try to compute. You have a nice nonlinear algebraic equation. This is not a differential equation. This is an algebraic equation. You solve a nonlinear algebraic equation and V300 happened to be 45. So what is your limiting velocity? You want 340. So by the drum it reaches that 300 feet, the velocity will cross the limiting velocity of 40 and there is a chance of breaking the drum and this project was abandoned. Of course when you scientists give the report, the government will take it seriously. We may not say that our lakes and rivers are polluted, you stop dumping chemicals. Nobody will listen to that, right? They may stop dumping in that time, they will dump it night. So you may not know it will do it. So that's a very, so the tail to the tail, yeah, tail already at top. Okay, there is no more a tail now. Only tail is, since tail is told already, there is no tail. Okay. Yeah, this is another example, but I will stop it. I think good enough time, right? This is a problem if you do it in a one of the mechanical vibration model, an LCR model. Basically, you want to understand, especially in your bikes, etc. You say always talk about shock absorbers, etc. Right? How do they design your shock absorber? How the shocks are absorbed? Okay, how do you do such things? If you don't do such kind of absorption, you cannot drive through the road, right? Especially through our roads with a lot of humps and lot of potholes. So you need, even our own, whatever bikes you get with absorbers are not enough to handle our Bangalore or Mangalore roads. You need an infinite amount of shock absorbers to travel. Whatever it is, shock absorbers and all that. So you will have models. This is the same thing why you get your signals, all these models are here. So go and read that, it is explained here. Okay? Yeah, that's all. So there are many things. This is the book. This is the website you can download my video lectures. Okay? Thank you.
The session is open for questions. If you all have any questions, you can come in front and ask him now.
She's half an hour waiting to announce this. So she was so tense whether I will forget some words. Right? For the last half an hour, she is ready with the mic. The session is over. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable insights. It was indeed a wonderful session. Thank you so much, sir.
Discontinuous on rational. So who do you argue is that now? Is the discontinuous on rationals? Take it as before. Xn is any irrational sequence. Irrational sequence converging to a rational number x naught. X naught is any rational number. But f of xn is equal to 0. Therefore, it is cannot be equal to 1 by q or any. As n goes to infinity, cannot be converged to 1 by q. Therefore, it is a discontinuous at rational. Now, how do you prove that it is a continuous at irrational? How do you argue it now? Continuous at irrational. Now it is not easy to construct a sequence and check it. So what we do is that in the negation. So suppose if it is, suppose I will go in a contradictory derivative. Suppose f is discontinuous at irrational. Discontinuous at irrational. My claim is that it is a continuous. But let us go in the opposite way, negation way. Suppose it is a discontinuous at irrational, then what do you expect? Suppose x naught is an irrational, at this point it is a discontinuous. How do you argue that? If it is an irrational sequence, if you take, then it is obviously it is continuous. So what is the sequence you should take? Suppose if it is discontinuous, then this implies there exists a rational sequence. Rational sequence xn is equal to bn by 2n, okay, such that xn converges to x naught and such that f of xn does not converge to f of x naught. That is what my claim. If it is discontinuous, then what should happen? Xn converges to x naught, but f of xn converges to, does not converge to f of x naught. That means there exists an epsilon greater than 0. There exists an epsilon greater than 0. Xn converges to x naught, but f of xn minus f of x naught is greater than or equal to epsilon. Maybe for some n greater than n. This happens if it is a discontinuous function. So what is f of xn? F of xn is a rational sequence of this one is 1 by qn. Since x naught is an irrational number, it is 0. Therefore, this is greater than or equal to epsilon. So without loss of generality, assume that qn's are positive, because if it is a minus sign is there, I take it in the numerator. Because it is of the form pn by pn, I will make qn is always positive. Therefore, this implies 1 greater than or equal to qn, epsilon greater than 0. Okay? So this happens. If it is a discontinuous function, then there is a rational sequence xn converges to x naught and an epsilon greater than 0, such that this happens. So now, 2n is an integer, sequence of integers, multiplied by epsilon, and it is bounded by 1. How many integers you can find in a bounded interval? That means, 2n is bounded by 1 by epsilon, and 0 is this. How many integers you can find in an interval? Bounded interval, how many integers you can find? In a bounded interval, how many integers you can find? Finite number, no? Whatever may be the big number, in a bounded, once it is bounded, number of positive integers are finite quantity. So now only there is a finite number of qn's satisfying this condition. In a sequence, if I remove a finite number of points, it does not affect our convergence, no? Isn't it? In a sequence, if you remove the finite number of points in a sequence, convergence is not affected. Therefore, now I will redefine the xn by xn prime, removing those finite number of that. Then xn prime also goes to x0. So once those points are removed, then this does not hold. That means opposite is holding. This implies f has to be continuous at irrational. So the next question is, what I asked is that is it possible to construct a function which is discontinuous on irrationals, continuous on rationals? This is a slightly difficult question. So that needs answer is wrong. You cannot construct a function which is continuous on rationals and discontinuous on irrationals. So for that, I will define another definition of continuity called the via the oscillations function. That is the, suppose f is a function from say R1 to R1, just I will take that one. U is any open bounded set. Open bounded set. Okay. The oscillation of f of u on omega f of u equals supremum of f of x, x belongs to u, minus infimum of f of x, x belongs to u. Suppose the function is like this in the interval u, the maximum value is this one, the minimum value is this one, the difference. So it measures the height of the function. So this is always a non-negative function. This is always a non-negative function. Supremum is always bigger than the infimum, therefore it is a non-negative function. Suppose you can check that u1 less than u2, what happens? Omega f of u1 is less than or equal to omega f of u2 because of this one, u1. Contained here, supremum of u1 is bounded by the supremum of u2. Infimum of u1 is greater than the infimum of u2. Therefore, this happens. So now, I will define the oscillation function. Oscillation function, yep, at x now. This is, I have defined that on a bounded open set. So I will define as the omega f of x naught is equal to infimum of, okay, omega f u, x naught belongs to u. I will take all the open sets, omega f, x open sets u containing x naught, I will define omega f of u. And I take all the possible infimum. Infimum, that means. Yeah. So my claim is f is continuous. F is continuous at x naught if and only if omega of f of x naught is 0. The oscillation becomes, suppose u is merging to a point, supremum becomes the infimum. If it is a continuous, suppose the function is discontinuous here, any open interval containing this discontinuous point, supremum is this one, infimum is this one. There is a break in the graph, then this won't become zero. Suppose if it is a continuous function, then it is that. So I will quickly give the proof of this one. Suppose f is great, continuous. Continuous. This implies u and epsilon greater than 0. There is a delta such that f of x minus f of x naught less than epsilon whenever mod of x minus x naught less than delta. So this implies f of x minus f of x naught less than epsilon minus epsilon. Okay. Therefore, this implies f of x minus less than or equal to f of x naught plus epsilon. Supremum of f of x now, in that interval I will take here, x minus x naught, this is my ball, u. U is the ball, is V delta x. Okay. So that means supremum of f of x on that ball is equal to supremum of f of x. X belongs to u is less than or equal to f of x naught plus f naught. Similarly, if I take this side f of x naught, this implies f of x naught minus epsilon is f of x. Therefore, the bounded below, therefore I can take the infimum, therefore the infimum of x naught because it's the bounded below. Now you take the difference f of x naught plus epsilon, since this is greater than or equal to, minus is less than or equal to this quantity. Therefore, if I take the opposite side, then what happens? This minus this, f of x naught cancel. So we will be having omega of f of v naught, v delta x naught is less than 2 epsilon. If I choose epsilon by 2, then it reduces to the epsilon. Therefore, any choice of epsilon, omega of f, v delta x naught, now the omega of f of x naught is equal to infimum of all possible over the balls. In fact, this is less than or equal to, because the infimum, I am choosing a particular choice of this v delta x naught. Therefore, omega f of v delta x naught less than 2 epsilon. For every choice of epsilon, this implies omega of f of x naught is 0. Therefore, if f is continuous, if and only if omega of f of x naught is 0, I am taking this as the definition, I have to construct another function that there exists no continuous function which is continuous on rationals and discontinuous on irrationals. For that, I need this kind of extra way of, another way of defining the continuous function. So now, this is the first statement. I have proved that f is continuous if and only if omega of f of x naught is 0. So now another set, I will consider ER. R is any real number, R is positive, is a set of R x such that omega of f of x greater than or equal to 1 by R. I will construct this set of all x. I have defined omega f of x. That is the difference of, that is the infimum of all omega f of u. My claim is that this is a closed set. My claim is that it is a closed set. Is a closed set. So that means, closed set means what? It contains all its limit points. Okay? So a set is said to be closed, it contains all its limit points. So suppose x naught is the limit point of ER. X naught is a limit point of ER. What I have to prove now? X naught is the limit point of ER. What I have to prove? I have to prove ER is closed. X naught is in ER. I should be able to prove X naught is in ER. That means omega of f of X naught should be greater than or equal to ER. So you have one nice result. X naught is the limit point of a set E. Then suppose another interval J contains x naught, then j contains, suppose j is any open set, okay, x naught is the limit point of ER, x naught belongs to j, j is an open set, then j contains, tell me, somebody is telling, j contains at least one point other than x naught, or in fact on the real line it contains infinitely many points. J contains at least one point other than x naught. There is a y, belongs to ER, and y belongs to J, and y is not equal to x naught, isn't it? So now omega of f of x naught, omega of f of x naught is equal to, okay. Now I am taking the infimum of all the j's, infimum of all omega f j, x naught belongs to j. They are the all possible open sets contain this one. This omega f j contains y of er other than x naught. Therefore, this is should be greater than or equal to infimum of x naught belongs to j omega of f of y. This omega j, I'm keeping the infimum as it is. Omega f j is greater than or equal to omega f y, because again with the definition of omega f x. Okay, so this is greater than or equal to 1 by r, because y is in ER. Therefore, x naught belongs to ER. Therefore, ER is a closer set. ER is a closer set. So, what we have proved that ER is a closer set. Second, we have proved that ER is a closer set. Now, I would like to see that f is any arbitrary function, how this set looks like, set of all x such that f of x is discontinuous. How this set looks like, I wanted to see that x, f is any function, arbitrary function, need not be continuous, set of all x such that f of x is a discontinuous function. Suppose f is a monotone function, how it looks like. Now what are the discontinuities of a monotone function? Maximum. Suppose f may be discontinuous, may be a monotone, for example, greatest integer function. How many monotone function, how many discontinuities you can have? You must have studied the real analysis. The discontinuities of a monotone function are at most countable. I think this is at most countable. That means, suppose f is a monotone, the discontinuities are countable. Countable, this set is a countable set. That means it can be written as the countable set, therefore I can written as the XM. Because countable set, I can arrange it as a sequence, countable union of closer sets. So this result is true in general. The set, whatever may be the function f, the set of all discontinuities is equal. This is our next aim, is to prove that. We would like to prove that this can be written as the countable union of closed sets. This is, I will call it the discontinuous set, is the countable union of closed sets. This is what I wanted to prove now. Okay? So now in the monotone function, it is true. Each fn is a xn, one single point. Countable union of a closed set, any set of discontinuities, or in other words, it is a, what you call this set is called, f sigma set, countable union of closer sets. That's called the f sigma sets. Now, how do you prove it? Now, let us characterize this one. Suppose f is discontinuous. I wanted to see how this set looks like. Okay, f is discontinuous means the set of all x such that omega of f of x greater than 0. Omega f of x is a non-negative function, oscillation function. If it is continuous, then it has to be equal to 0. Therefore, this one. This is, I am writing as D. This set D is nothing but the set of all x such that omega f of x is positive. Isn't it? Because it's a discontinuous. So this I am writing as D. Set of all x such that omega, this can be written as the n is equal to 1 to infinity, omega of f of x is greater than or equal to 1 by n. All the possible, greater than 0 means they can exist. I am taking this 1 by n. Okay, this is a any function, f of omega of f of x is positive number, can be written as the all the possible. It can 1 by n greater than 1 by n, okay? Then is equal to 1, it is 1, 2, 3, like that. And it is n going to infinity. So it becomes a very small number. But we proved that it is a closed set. Therefore, it is a countable union of the closed sets. All the discontinuities of a function, whatever may be the function is, that can be written as the countable union of the closed sets. Okay? Now come to the example what I was telling. Suppose there exists a function. Suppose there exists a function f is continuous on rationals, and discontinuous on irrationals. Suppose such a function exists. Suppose there exists such a function, then I should be able to write the discontinuous set. This should be a countable union of closed sets. I should be able to write all the irrational numbers should be a countable union of the closed sets. Irrational numbers, set of all irrational numbers. Is it possible to write countable union of closed sets, the irrational numbers? Rational numbers, it is fine. Because union of x sense you can write. Countable union of a closed set. Is it possible? It is not possible. You cannot write that. Countable union of a closed set, irrational. Each set is closed. Okay? Only contains the irrational. Because you know that irrationals are uncountable. Suppose if it is possible. There is a theorem in the functional analysis. If you have already studied the functional analysis, Bayer category theorem. Any complete metric space is of second category. That means it cannot be written as a countable union of nowhere then sets. Okay. Suppose what happens? Suppose if it is possible, since Fn's are closer, that is itself Fn. Because Fn's are closer. Now what is the interior? Nowhere then set is, you take a set, you take a closer and interior, if it is an empty, then we will say that is a nowhere then set. What is it? This is interior of a irrational numbers, what is that? What is the interior of anthropology? What is the interior of an irrational number? In R1. Interior you followed, no? No, empty, because irrational number does not contain any interval. Interior means a point x naught in a set is set to be an interior point, then that it should be in an interval, that interval is contained in that set. So it does not contain, this shows that this is an empty set. Suppose if it is true, suppose all irrational numbers can be written as the countable union of the nowhere then sets, then what happens? And rationals are also I am writing as the countable union of the nowhere then sets. Add these two, that is nothing but R1, real numbers can be written as the countable union of the nowhere then sets. That is the contradictory to the Bayer category theorem. So this is a typical question in these MSc students. Is it that the first one can be asked in the BSc level? This is the, this you need the functional analysis. That means any complete matrix space is of the second category, not of the first category. That means it cannot be written as the countable union of the nowhere dense sets. So this is a very nice example. So another simple example, f is a continuous function from R1 to R1, is continuous, and f of x plus y is equal to f of x plus f of y. So what can you say about the f? What can you say about the f? It satisfies the linear property, but except another property, f of alpha y is not equal to alpha into f of y. Doesn't have that quantity, but still for a continuous function with this additive property, then it has to be a linear. We need not to write another f of alpha y is equal to alpha into f of y. We need not to write. Then f is can be written as the f of x, a line passing through the origin. F of x has to be a line passing through the origin if this is, if f is continuous, the question is simple, because you can check that f of 0 is equal to f of 0 plus 0. F of 0 can be written as 0 plus 0 f by additivity. F of 0 is equal to 2 of f of 0. Therefore, this implies f of 0 is equal to 0. F of n, you can check that f of 2, f of 1 plus f of 1, that is 2 into f of 1. Therefore, in general, f of n, I am just writing it, you check that, n into f of 1. Okay? So f of rational numbers, I will check it now. Any m into n into m by n, that is equal to f of m. Okay. Similarly, I will check here that f of mx is equal to m into f of x, because m times x plus x plus x plus x, m times I will write it. Repeating argument, you use this one. Therefore, this is equal to n times of f of m by n, but f of m, the integers, you will have that m into f of 1. Therefore, sorry, I have taken n here, this is n here, this is n here. Therefore, this implies n into f of m, and sorry, this is m, n into m into divided by n, therefore m f of m, this is m. Therefore f of m by n is also equal to m by n into f of 1. See, all the properties is satisfied with alpha equals f of 1. Okay, you can check that. So it is true for integers, it is true for rationals, therefore it is true for the irrationals. How do you argue it? Now use that. F is continuous. Still I have not used the f is continuous. Okay? So since f is continuous, now sequence xn of rationals converges into an irrational number x. Okay? Xn converges to x. Now by this, since the result is true for the rationals, f of xn is equal to f of 1 into xn, because the result is true for rationals. Since xn converges to x, this goes to the f of 1 into x, this goes to f of x. Therefore, even result is true for the irrationals. Now I am using that rationals are dense. Okay. Now if you have a measure theory course, this is only for a continuity. If you have a measure theory course, you have the already measure theory course, measure and integration. Now I will continuity is continuous. When it is a continuous, it is obvious to check f of x plus y is equal to f of x plus f of y. Then it is a f is a line passing through the origin. Now I am not assuming f is continuous, because if it is continuous, I have this choice: x n converges to x, f of x n converges to f of x. I will use that. Except that now instead of continuity is replaced by the f is a measurable function. Measurable functions can be discontinuous. For example, this function is measurable. It is discontinuous at every point. X is rational, 0, x is irrational. Every point is a discontinuous, but it is a measurable function. Okay? So f r1 to r1 is a measurable function satisfying the property f of x plus of f of y is equal to f of x plus f of y. This implies f is continuous. Continuous. Once it is continuous, this result is true. Therefore, if f is measurable, okay, therefore the general result is f is measurable if and only if measurable plus additive, then it is continuous. Any continuous function is measurable. So this result, f is measurable function, measurability, additivity implies the function is continuous. Once it is continuous, then it is a line passing through the origin. How do you prove this one? So now I have to prove that measurability plus additivity implies the continuity. How do you prove it? In the measure theory, there is three principles. Any measurable set is very nearly to the countable union of intervals. Any measurable function is nearly a continuous function. Any measurable convergence is a nearly an equivalent, a uniform convergence. That is called the little root three principles. So under this heading, you will study, if a set E is measurable, then there exists, given any epsilon greater than 0, there exists an open set O contains E such that measure of E is less than epsilon. That means measurable set can be approximated by the open set. It is any measurable set is very close to an open set. Therefore, given any epsilon positive, you can find an open set contains a E, measure of O minus E is epsilon, given any choice of epsilon. Okay. Next, have you heard the Lucin's theorem? This is 1, 2, Lucin's theorem. So this is also in the measure and integration. That means, if f is a measurable function, f is measurable, or I say from A to B to R, just I will take a finite one, f is measurable AB to R, then given epsilon greater than 0, since AB is a compact set, there exists a compact set f such that measure of that interval AB minus F is less than epsilon and F is continuous on capital F. Continuous on F. If F, small f is a measurable function, then you can find a closed subset of a interval AB. Then in that, on that F is a continuous function. And the difference between the original set AB and F is not much. So that means it's almost nearly to a continuous function. So using this theorem, I can prove that additivity and this theorem, we can prove it as a continuous function. Then the result follows. So I will leave it as an exercise. The idea is that using the Lucas theorem. So this is the, I'm just covering the continuous function, some with some examples. So now I'm moving slowly to the uniform continuity. Why the purpose of continuity? Why one has to study the uniform continuity? Okay. So your continuity, we feel that it is not enough. So you move to the uniform continuity. Why one has to study that? Okay. So now, f is a continuous function from a closed interval AB, say compact set. The image of a continuous image of a compact set is compact. Therefore, f is bounded. Suppose if you don't take a compact set, it is not true. For example, f is a continuous function from the interval 0,1 to R1. Okay? F is continuous. Does not imply f is bounded. So closed interval, if you take an open interval 0,1, f may be continuous, but it is not bounded. Can you give an example? F of x is equal to 1 by x. Yeah, that is a beautiful idea. F of x is equal to 1 by x. Now I want to add something to the continuity so that if f is continuous plus that property, should give that f is bounded. That is, f is uniformly continuous, uniformly continuous on an interval AB, then f is bounded. This was the lacking in the case of a continuity. If f is uniformly continuous on an open interval AB, then f has to be bounded. Then this implies 1 by x is not a uniformly continuous function. Log x is not a uniformly continuous function. You can exclude past. Okay? So this is the, f is uniformly continuous on an interval AB means f is continuous on the closure of the interval AB. So now how to define the uniform continuity? Now let me back to the uniform continuity definition. So tell me, what is that? Given epsilon greater than 0, you cannot avoid the epsilon delta definition. There exists a delta greater than 0, delta is independent of the x, it is dependent upon only on the epsilon, such that mod of f of x minus f of y is less than epsilon whenever mod of x minus y less than delta. So the uniform continuity is depend on a set, not at a particular point. Uniform continuity is defined on a set. So continuity is defined on a particular point. It's a continuous at a point x naught. Uniform continuity is defined on a set E. Okay. So given epsilon f is set to be uniformly continuous on a set E. Given epsilon greater than 0, there exists delta greater than 0, such that delta depends not on the x naught, on the individual point, any arbitrary point. Okay. Because it's for every choice of x and y in E, for all x and y in E. So it is an independent of x. So in this choice, so we say that it is a uniformly continuous. So it is practically, sometimes it is very difficult to find this epsilon delta, practically. No, that is not uniformly continuous, for example, when the function is very complicated. So again, we will negation argument, we will find some theorem so that it is easy to find it. So that suppose if it is not uniformly continuous, let me go to that definition. But if that is easy to understand, rather than checking it is uniformly continuous. Let me start with an example, simple example. F is a map from R1 to R1. F of x is equal to x square. Okay? Is it uniformly continuous? On every interval AB it is true, because on a compact set, continuity implies the uniform continuity, isn't it? If F is continuous on a compact set, then it is uniformly on K. But here, it is not there. So is it true? F of x is equal to x, where is it uniformly continuous? Yes, suppose it is true. Now the proof, I will go to the negative version, hope you that it is easy to prove rather than this one. Suppose I want to prove that it is not uniformly continuous. On every closed interval AB, it is uniformly continuous, but not on the whole R1. Suppose it is uniformly continuous. Given an epsilon is equal to half, there is a delta greater than 0 such mod of f of x minus f of y less than, suppose it is uniformly continuous, I am taking epsilon is equal to half, is less than half whenever mod of x minus y less than delta. For any choice of x and y in R1, the uniform continuity means, for any choice of x and y in Rn, if this happens, this should hold. Okay. Now I will take y as the x plus delta by 2. Mod of y minus x obviously satisfying this condition, isn't it? Therefore, this is equal to f of x is equal to x square minus y square modulus x minus y into x plus y. Y is equal to, I am taking particular choice. This is true for every choice of x and y, that is uniform continuity. I am taking this one, this implies x minus y is equal to, okay, fine, I will, this is delta by 2, okay, and R, you take that x is equal to y plus delta by 2, okay, you take that any choice, x is equal to y plus delta by 2. Delta by 2 plus x into 2x plus delta by 2. Okay. Now, but my choice is that f of x minus f of y is less than half. It is less than half. Is it true for every choice of x? Delta by 2, 2x plus delta by 2 is less than half for every choice of x in R1. Is it true? As x goes to infinity, this flows up. Isn't it? This goes to infinity. Cannot be bounded by half. Therefore, it is not uniformly continuous. But the function is here, it is it is easy to handle because I can split as x minus y, x plus y. I took this choice, I got this, the contradiction. But in general, it is not easy to check it. So I will come to the definition of f is not uniformly continuous. Not uniformly continuous. And it is not uniformly continuous. That means where x at epsilon greater than 0, f is such that for every delta positive, there exists two points, x naught and y naught, such that mod of x naught minus y naught less than delta and mod of f of x minus f of y is greater than or equal to f. Then a question. If it is not uniformly continuous, then for every direction epsilon greater than 0, such that whatever may be the delta, whatever may be the choice of your delta, this happens, but opposite happens. For every choice of delta, delta is of your choice. For every delta of your choice, you will have this. So if this is not true, then this definition is true. Definition of uniform continuity. So since this is true for every choice of the delta, I can take delta is equal to 1 by n. Then what happens? For every delta is equal to 1 by n, there is a point xn and yn such that uniformly not continuous implies 1 by n and f of xn minus f of yn greater than or equal to epsilon. For every delta there exists two points. Therefore, for every delta 1 by n, there exists point xn and yn such that this happens. This implies what? As n, for every choice of the n, this implies xn minus yn. Now I wanted to see that, look, this definition of continuity. When do you say that f is continuous at a point? Xn converges to x0, f of xn converges to f of x0. I want something, that kind of definition for the uniform continuity, so that it is easy to check. So this says that xn yn goes to 0, but mod of f of xn minus f of yn greater than or equal to epsilon. That means f is not uniformly continuous implies there exists a sequence xn and yn, xn minus yn goes to 0. Okay. So that, but this is greater than or equal to epsilon. There is an epsilon, should be positive number. So this definition is more handy. It is very easy to check the given function is uniformly continuous or not. For example, come to the same example. Here, the beauty is that xn need not to converge, yn need not to converge, xn minus yn converges to 0. So this is the, in the continuity, xn converges to x, f of xn converges to f of x. Here I am not taking that. Xn, there exists a sequence xn and yn, such that xn yn separately need not to converge. Xn minus yn goes to 0, but that is greater than or equal to epsilon. If you are able to find such a thing, then you will say that it is not uniformly continuous. I will explain with this example, f of x is equal to x square. Now, my xn is equal to n, is a divergent sequence. Yn is equal to n plus 1 by n. So, xn minus yn goes to 0, isn't it? Xn, yn are not separately going to 0. Xn minus yn goes to 0, then what happens? Xn square plus yn square? Xn is n, that is n square minus n plus 1 the whole square, absolute value, what happens? N square cancels, 2 plus 1 by n square, see this is not going to 0, it is greater than or equal to epsilon, therefore it is not uniformly convergent. X square is very simple to find it. Then this difference is going to 0. But you check that this one, this 2, as n goes to 0, this goes to 2. So it is not going to 0. Therefore, it is not uniformly continuous. This is the one of the very another way of nice definition of uniform continuous. You can find that 1 by x now using this definition. 1 by x, how do you use it? by particular choice of this one. Okay? You take 1 by x may be 1 by n. Okay? Now, xn. See, 1 by x to prove the finding the delta ends on it is not easy. Here, 1 by x wanted to prove. Now, again you take x is equal to 1 by n. Y is there as the 1 by n plus 1. Okay? Now, what happens? Xn minus yn is a convergent sequence. This goes to 0. What is f of xn minus f of yn? What is it? What is it? Xn 1 by xn, that is n minus of n plus 1 is equal to 1, it is not going to 0. Therefore, it is not uniformly continuous. So, that struggling of finding the delta and epsilon, you can avoid it. But this is another way of checking. So, another beautiful example I told that even you need not to go suddenly, okay? Suddenly, by looking at a function, to check that. So, for example, f is that's what the first I started with that f is continuous, sorry, uniformly continuous is the general statement. Uniformly continuous on a bounded interval, on a bounded interval AB, then f has to be bounded. So, these kinds of examples, log x in the interval 0, 1. Interval 0, 1 is bounded. Log x is not bounded. Therefore, it is not uniformly continuous. 1 by x, it is not uniformly continuous. You can exclude. So, these kinds of negation definitions, they are more. Whenever you go to the definition, immediately you find the what is the negation definition. And negation definition gives you more important, more ideas, so that you can handle the things. Maybe this one time is there. I don't know how much of time I have. Time is there. Okay. Oh, over. Okay. So I will leave it as an exercise. So it is available. I think in all the things what I have told, it is in the exercise section of the Walter Wood, more or less. Okay. Thank you. The next class I am talking on the discontinuous function.